Daily news and analysis. We keep you informed and inspired.
This is World Today.
Welcome to World Today, a news program with a different perspective. I'm Liu Kun in Beijing. In this edition, we discuss Chinese President Xi Jinping's recent trip to Central Asia. President Xi Jinping has attended the 24th meeting of the Council of Heads of State of the Shanghai Cooperation Organization in Astana and paid state visits to Kazakhstan and Tajikistan. Among a series of documents on cooperation in energy, investment, and more, the SCO meeting adopted the Astana Declaration, which reaffirmed commitment of member states to building a new type of international relations and a community with a shared future for mankind. So what's the significance of the SCO Astana Summit? Why does Central Asia matter for China and vice versa? For these questions and more, I'm joined by Dr. He Wenping, Senior Research Fellow at Chinese Academy of Social Sciences, Dr. Mher Sahakyan, Founder and Director of the China-Eurasia Council for Political and Strategic Research, a foundation in Armenia. Also, we have Professor Doug Guthrie, Director of China Initiatives at Thunderbird School of Global Management. A big welcome to all of you, and we appreciate your participation in this very important panel discussion. First of all, let me start by asking Dr. He, please. Overall, how do you comment on the significance of this summit in Kazakhstan? What's its role in the development of SCO as a regional organization?
I think this summit, of course, is very important because ever since SCO founded in the year 2001 in Shanghai. So this summit has been always, you know, carry on, already building on this mechanism as a collective dialogue among all those member countries. And even this time around, most significance is now this is called the SCO Plus meeting. Plus, because now not only nine members, now with a new member Belarus joined in. So, and together with those opposition countries and also dialogue partner countries, now all together. So it's called PLUS. So which means this mechanism itself has been serving as a very, attractive, this kind of a platform for many, many countries around. And also this time around, given the background of international situation. Well, you see a lot of conflicts going on, and then so this mechanism itself we are going to build on itself as a positive forces for building a peaceful, secure this regional security situation, and also make contribution for this global international security. How to make SCO's contribution for global this peace and development. So I think that's a very significant importance for this time summit.
Dr. Sahakyan, what's your take?
At first, thank you very much for inviting me to join this very important meeting. I think that this summit was very important because 14 leaders from different states and UN Secretary General joined to this summit, making it one of the important events in this year. And of course, you know that now Shanghai Cooperation Organization has also newcomers as dialogue partners from Middle East, and we have also Belarus as a Eastern European state joining as a member. And now it is already clear that it is an organization of several regions, not only one or two, but several regions, which is giving continental importance to Shanghai Cooperation Organization.
Now, Professor Guthrie, welcome back to the show again. How, in your observation as a longtime China observer, where does this summit in Kazakhstan stand in the overall development of the SCO?
Thank you so much for having me. It's wonderful to be here with this esteemed panel, and it's always a joy to be in conversations with you all. I don't disagree with anything that my co-panelists just said. The one thing I would just add here is I think we are at a critical moment for China in its positioning in the global economy. I think 2023 was just a remarkable year for China. And as I've said before on this show, and I'll just repeat it again, I think that it has just been atrocious the way China has been treated by the United States and a number of other leading economies around the world. As China has grown to be the second largest economy in the world over the last 40 years, it still only sits at the kids' table. You know, there's the G7, which is all of the self-appointed most important economies and geopolitical systems in the world. And they would argue that the G7 is based on capitalist democracies, but we know that's not true because in 2008 they let Russia in and it became the G8, and then they pushed Russia out because of Crimea in 2013. But China has always been sort of at the kids' table. Well, you can be with the G20. And I think China's just tired of it. And they're just, you know, but they haven't been threatening in this position. They've just been continuing to grow, continuing to do their work in building a very strong, the most effective and powerful manufacturing supply chain in the world, the second largest economy in the world, probably in 7 years will be the largest economy in the world. And I think 2023 was a year when President Xi said, okay, we're going to show that we're in a different position. And so we saw the brokering of the Iran-Saudi peace deal. We saw China's positioning just with the Belt and Road Initiative. And so I think this Shanghai Cooperation Organization meeting is yet another moment to say, OK, like this is the year when we're going to show that we're actually doing a lot more. We see the reorganization of the G20 or of the BRICS in 2023 as well. And so I think this is another moment to show like this isn't just a symbolic organization where a bunch of smaller, less powerful countries are playing. This is China being the leader of the global south and say, sitting with Russia and a number of other important nations and saying, OK, we have our own group of organizations, and we're going to continue to be influential in this positioning. And so to me, this meeting, even though there's just a lot of details that happen that we need to go through, I actually think this is a more significant meeting than has been the case for the Shanghai Cooperation Organization in many years.
Well, thank you for putting, you know, the economics factor, you know, into this discussion. Well, during this year's Astana meeting, the schedule of these leaders are rather packed. The meeting adopted the Astana Declaration together with a series of other documents. There's, you know, documents on forging friendly neighbors and also partners. There's also document on investment, on energy, on infrastructure, etc. Dr. Sahakyan, which one or which ones do you think matter the most and why?
You are right. Sides developed 16 new documents, but I want mostly to focus on Astana Declaration because it is settling a roadmap for further developments in this organization. We need to remember that China, Russia, and Central Asian countries settled this organization mostly for security issues. And now we have newcomers, and they are bringing with them also security issues as well. Also, we have still Afghanistan's moment in the table, Iranian nuclear issue, and now as we have Arabic states in this organization as dialogue partner. So for this reason, in Astana Declaration, all these moments, also Israeli-Palestinian issue, were raised, and sides tried to mention how these problems can be settled. Also, in Astana Declaration, it is worth mentioning that it is making some kind of remarks on further economic relations and transportation infrastructure, because Central Asia is very important as it is as a bridge between China, South Caucasus, West Asia, Russia. And for this reason, they tried to make some kind of recommendations how to develop this all. And of course, we are speaking about opportunities, but we also need to speak about some challenges. As now, of course, it is great that Belarus, Iran are joining, but we need to mention that they are under sanctions and it can bring some kind of problems for economic cooperation and big projects in Shanghai Cooperation Organization. Mm-hmm. For this reason, sides need to find ways for developing economic relations in this situation as well.
Mm. Dr. He, which documents or which topics are really caught your attention during the summit?
If we talk about the summit, of course, a lot of highlights are now catch the people's eyes, of course, including myself, like this member enlargement, now from 9 members becoming 10 members, 10 members. And also another thing is China was going to be the next rotation, this chair country from the 2024 to 2025. So those are all the high moments. If we talk about this Astana Declaration, of course, it covered a lot of the contents, like my colleague just mentioned, a lot of elements. But I want to highlight, talk about the BRI, Belt and Road Initiative. Mm. Many countries make clear they continue to support BRI, to against those trade protectionism, and also saying the coming year, 2025, will be named as called the Sustainable Development Year. I think this is very important because it means SCO, not just saying this is eyes on security, anti-terror, because this is, of course, the most important content of this SCO used to be, folks. But now development, sustainable development, also becoming one of the very important folks from SCO. Mm-hmm. I also noticed the one report published even in the year 2022 saying all the past 20 years, those trade volume among all those members of SCO already increased nearly 100 times more than 20 years ago. Mm-hmm. You see, this is thing happening. Even the percentage, our trade among the SCO countries, if you're considering the percentage in the global trade, also increased a lot. Yeah, from 2001, like only 5.4%, now already after 20 years, increased to 17.5%. Mm. So without those trade, without those development, investment, economic development, like just my colleague just mentioned, China's importance, number two, biggest economy, why those G7 countries talking about global economy, mm. Even without, the war is coming from the second biggest economy. Mm. So couldn't be. So now this SCO also need to follow this kind of direction to further develop our cooperation and make 2025 as a sustainable development year. I think this is very important, this kind of a trend.
Mm. Professor Guthrie, it's only the economic and trade and investment, side of these topics, standing out to you? Do you have other observations?
No, I think I agree with what my colleagues just said. And let me just emphasize, while I do focus a lot on the economy and the economic growth as a critical thing and just the dramatic success of China's economic transformation over the last 40 years, it's really important to understand that the economy is important, but it also serves China's positioning in the global geopolitical system. And so the stronger China's economy becomes, the more it just has to be acknowledged as a leader in the world. And so it's not just the economy that matters to me, but it's the ways in which the positioning in the economy and the success in the economy continues to lend weight to mm-hmm. China's position. I mean, so just to echo what my colleague said, I mean, there's a very nice balance in the SCO documents, because on the one hand, in moments like this, you have the big document like the Astana Declaration, mm-hmm. but then you have lots of smaller documents that talk about things very specifically like sustainable growth. But it's very critical, I think, in the Astana Declaration that we're talking, the word multipolar world is used. Mm. And the multipolar world is not, again, Professor He just said, and I said previously, but this is a really important counterbalance to this hubris of the G7 thinking they're the most important economies in the world. No, China is equally important, but it's not just important as an economy and a fuel for growth in the world. It's also important as part of the multipolar system in which, you know, China is going to continue to have as big of an influence in Central Asia and Eurasia as the United States is. And so I think it's a really important thing to balance the economy in service of China's positioning in the geopolitical system.
Mm. Well, let's take a look at some specifics of Chinese President Xi Jinping's remarks at the summit. So he called on participating countries to fend off Cold War mentality and small yard high fences risks. He also called on, you know, these people to oppose external interference into regional affairs. He called on all sides to adhere to the Shanghai spirit. Dr. Sahakyan, how do you understand the background of his remarks? And what's in essence about this Shanghai spirit?
As President Xi mentioned, it is about Shanghai spirit. And I think that he wanted to emphasize about equality of states which are involved in Shanghai Cooperation Organization. It is about that China, India, Russia, or our great powers, they are not leaders. It is about equality, good neighborliness, and friendship between countries which are attending in Shanghai Cooperation Organization. We need to remember that Shanghai Cooperation Organization, it is not a union or something like a European Union, Soviet Union, but it is organization where states are coming on their own and they have equality to choose. And for this reason, there is also very important to mention that dialogue among civilizations, which is trying to promote Shanghai Cooperation Organization, and President Xi also mentioned about it. Of course, multipolar world order 2.0 is making problems in this era because some states are weaponizing economic sanctions. They are trying to go for leadership in some regions. But I do believe that Shanghai Cooperation Organizations need to put more attention on equality and Shanghai spirit. It will help to bring a mutual benefit.
Mm. Now, Dr. He, how do you understand, you know, the background of President Xi Jinping's remarks? Why was he specifically, you know, mentioning these risks?
Oh, yes, because this is now the background we are facing, especially in recent years. Some country like the United States, even recently, European Union also follow, like Americans' way, for example, increase those tax for China-made those EV electronic cars. It's really, you know, unbelievable, this kind of trade protectionism, saying China's this EV, because this very good one, environment-friendly one, actually should be welcome very much for our global, you know, effort to deal with this global warming. But you see, Biden administration increased tax to China-made EV, from like a 25% all the way to 105% tax. And the EU also follow suit, make announcement, also will increase from 15% like to 38%. So those are the thing like President Xi Jinping mentioned called the small yard, high fences, this risk. This is dangerous. There are some people talking about some politician, even ever since Donald Trump, American former president, saying de-link, decouple, and later on, some politicians saying, wow, we don't talk about decouple, de-link. Maybe now just focus on de-risk. Actually, the de-risk or decouple, de-link all comes with same, this kind of Cold War mentality, which means they think development pie just as same as it used to be. And then if China got more pie from that cake, which means, wow, you touch the other people's teeth, or their pie should be get less. I think this is Cold War mentality, zero-sum game thinking. But now with this common, like Shanghai spirit, talking about the common development. Yeah, common development. We make that pie bigger. So even though China gets more, or let the U.S. get more doesn't necessarily mean other partners, you get less. You also get more. This is called win-win-win. Yeah, this is called multilateralism. This is called we join together to build like a shared community of humankind. Not like when I feel some competition is getting stronger, I immediately do the fund yard building and getting some small settling called small yard, just bringing some allied countries together. Let's do a small circulation of all those productivity, those factors. And then this is also called the deglobalization. Of course, it's not beneficial at all for global this economy. Also, not benefit at all for many other those small and developing countries.
Now, Professor Guthrie, in light of what we've been discussing, you know, the strategic competition between China and United States, I understand that, you know, people have different ideas and there's policy debates, you know, being more friendly and open toward China. Of course, there's also debates about being more hawkish toward China. But in general, help us understand the overall picture of the U.S. policy, you know, circle debate on these Cold War mentality and small yard high fences China is talking about. I mean, even are people even paying attention to these remarks?
Well, I mean, so first, to directly answer your question, are people paying attention to remarks about Xi Jinping at the SCO? Probably not. I mean, my own country, I'm sort of very sort of sad and embarrassed about the state of political dialogue going on in the United States right now. And so do people really know what's happening and do they have a clear sense of it? Not so much. But the issues, I think, are quite significant. So here you have President Xi really saying something that it sounds simple, but it's actually very deep in terms of where the world is right now. And probably he's pointing directly at the United States. So, you know, here we are in a situation in which the United States has been the largest economy in the world for decades. And it's in a very powerful position. Since 1980, this country that I live in has advocated for neoclassical economics theory and free markets, open markets, deregulation of the system. And then when China starts beating the United States in things like EV batteries and electric vehicles, Janet Yellen comes over to China and waves her finger and says, oh, stop dumping and stop overproducing and stop subsidizing. And then we start slapping tariffs on electric vehicles. China right now leads the world in the production of renewable energy, responsible energy manufacturing products, solar panels, EV batteries, electric vehicles. I mean, it's just astounding that the country is so far along in doing what we're doing. And now the United States, because we can't compete with China anymore in the manufacturing of these processes, we want to wave our finger and say, you're cheating. You're cheating in the market, when this is exactly what we would advocate. And what I believe the United States should be doing is following what President Xi is saying, and we should be collaborating. We should be partnering. We should be continuing to work together, not in small yards with high fences, but in an open market system, which we've been advocating all along. So I'm just very disappointed in the positioning of my own country on this, but I do believe that President Xi is sending a message. He's not just sending a message to the SCO countries, but to the United States itself, and saying we need to continue to think about an open dialogue, cooperation, collaboration, partnership, and not small yard high fences.
Well, we're wrapping up the first half of our discussion, but later during the program, we'll continue our discussion on the trip to Central Asia by Chinese President Xi Jinping. This is World Today. I'm Liu Kun in Beijing. We'll be right back. We'll be right back.
I am Dan Wang, Chief Economist of Hang Seng Bank China. The World Today is a real fun program. You will hear interesting people discussing global trend, economic event, what's happening in and outside of China. So, friends around the world, hope you can join us.
Welcome back to the show. I'm Liu Kun in Beijing. In this edition, we'll discuss Chinese President Xi Jinping's recent trip to Central Asia. We have with us Dr. He Wenping, Senior Research Fellow at Chinese Academy of Social Sciences, Dr. Mher Sahakyan, Founder and Director of the China-Eurasia Council for Political and Strategic Research, a foundation in Armenia. Also, we have Professor Doug Guthrie, Director of China Initiatives at Thunderbird School of Global Management. Now, continue with our discussion. This year's summit saw Belarus being added as a full member of the SCO. Dr. Sahakyan, what does this addition mean for both Belarus and SCO? How does it help both sides?
Actually, before this, Belarus has an observer status at Shanghai Cooperation Organization. It means that Belarus is not a newcomer to Shanghai Cooperation Organization, but it is only now getting this membership. Of course, it is good for reputation for the organization as it is extending. But as I have mentioned before, Shanghai Cooperation Organization also need to take into consideration the fact that Belarus is under sanction and it needs to find some ways for integration of Belarus as a member and finding some mechanism for solving these problems with sanctions that they do not harm to implement big project, economic project in a Shanghai Cooperation Organization.
Dr. He, what's your take on this?
Well, this is not a surprise for us to see now the Belarus becoming a member, because even a month ago, and Russia already released this information. So to my understanding, of course, this is mutually beneficial, either for SCO, of course, also for Belarus, and also particularly for the Russia. Russia would like very much to get Belarus becoming a member. We all know Belarus and Russia now is very close in any all kinds of ways, economically, even security, and also diplomatically. So now with Belarus as a member, and then, of course, for SCO, now it gets more membership and then GDP and then the size of the country, population, all becoming enlarged. This SCO, their platform, becoming expanded. Mm-hmm. And the SCO itself, before, when we talk about, why talk about the Shanghai spirit? Because different country, different culture, and also even different history, different religion, can all coexist in a harmonious way in this mechanism. For example, India and Pakistan. Mm. Normally as regarded as the, eye on eye, and then not, of course, not treated each other as a good way, but they also stay in a harmonious way in this SCO. So that will build on a new kind of a model for this international relations. So I think that's another, good meaning for this SCO, its own development.
Well, the SCO was born primarily for security reasons, as we have been discussing. Its predecessor, the Shanghai Five, was formed to manage border security issues after the end of the Cold War. Now, Professor Guthrie, does this remain the central mission of the SCO today, or do you see new responsibilities for this organization today?
Well, I think I would tack towards the latter part of your comment, because yes, in 2001, the formation was really built around the idea of security and managing borders. But today, I think this is, again, much more about sending signals on the coexistence of border security and the management of different countries' districts and regional economic development. I mean, again, I think it's not a coincidence that we have you know, so much more re-emphasis on BRI right now and the growth of this area, and then the kind of continuing leadership within the region and thinking about economic development and economic growth. I think it's interesting with Belarus because, you know, I think it makes this particular meeting more significant. Mm-hmm. This meeting wasn't just a meeting in which we're having conversations about sustainable growth and high quality development, et cetera. But we're also talking about new nations and new nations joining the group. And so I think China has always been doing this process of balancing what makes it significant and what makes it continuing along with the basic issues of economic development and growth. But I think that this is about much more than just security and border management right now. It's really about economic growth for the region.
Mm. Now, Dr. Sahakyan, in your observation, what's the general expectation in Central Asia, you know, about the central task or the mission of the organization today?
Well, Shanghai Cooperation Organization is very important for Central Asian states, as they still, we were speaking about Shanghai 5 and how why Shanghai 5 was born. But we need to mention that some problems still exist. For instance, Afghanistan's problem, which is making some kind of issues for Central Asian states. So for this reason, they are very interested in Shanghai Cooperation Organization, as it is helping them to settle and to find solutions for Afghanistan, taking into consideration also the fact that Afghanistan is also involved as a dialogue partner in Shanghai Cooperation Organization. And mm-hmm. of course, now we are living in 21st century, when if we compare with 20 years ago, now we have also cybersecurity issues, information security issues, and other issues. And of course, such states as China, India, and Russia are involved, they are having the Shanghai Cooperation Organization. They are helping to settle these issues for Central Asian states as well. And Central Asian states are also getting a keys of the markets of India, China, Russia, and they are getting an important role as transportation hub for Belt and Road Initiative, as we need to remember that two important mainland directions which are going from China towards Europe, I mean China, Central Asia, West Asia Economic Corridor, and New Eurasian Land Bridge, they are going for Central Asia, giving benefits to these countries. And of course, Shanghai Cooperation Organization as like fortifying and giving some kind of additional security to these transportation roads, to energy resources which are located in Central Asia and being shipped to China. So for this reason, Central Asian states, of course, have their benefit, and they are interested in keeping Shanghai Cooperation Organization.
Mm. Well, if you think about it, the size of economy and also population, you know, of these nations together really makes the organization, you know, more critical in today's world. But going to Dr. He Wenping, how do you see the mission of SCO today? And if the SCO is taking up more responsibilities, you know, in economic development, does this mean that the organization is deviating from its original purpose?
You know, even Shanghai Cooperation Organization also needs to keep the pace with the time, because it cannot be always stick to the original, their mission, their concern. Because originally, when it was founded in the year 2001, by that time, the Shanghai Five are mainly focused on this border, those security, how to, preventing those three forces. It's called the terrorist forces, extremist forces, religion extremist, those forces, three forces, because it matters very much to all those countries around their domestic security and even border security. But now with the time passed by, and then those anti-terror issue, three forces issue has been in great control. And then, of course, you should go beyond this original that domain. Now extended your concern to a big concept, especially when Chinese government put forward this One Belt, One Road initiative. Yeah, a lot of economic, like the corridor, development corridor has been linking from China to those Central Asian countries. Particularly, even Belt and Road initiative has been put forward at the first time in Kazakhstan when President Xi Jinping visited Kazakhstan, saying now is the time to revive the old traditional, that the Silk Road 2,000 years ago. So that is marked the time. Now we make this security, this cooperation now go all the way to moving to the economic cooperation. Now even goes to many more, not only political security and economically, now goes to people to people, there's a civilization dialogue and also other internationally cooperation. So many more now, not only one area or two areas. Now it's multi area.
Now, then, Dr. He, let me ask you this. How do you think China will distinguish its responsibilities, you know, within the Shanghai Cooperation Organization and another bloc that China is part of, which is BRICS, because BRICS is aimed for economic development as well? How do you think China will distinguish its responsibility within the two blocs, and are the two blocks really, you know, having overlapping missions?
Oh, yes, because either SCO or the BRICS, now we all call it a Global South, like a platform for uniting all those like emerging economy, developing country. Now even make a big concept called the Global South. Those Global South's voice should be heard when we're talking about global governance, like a global security, global peace and development. Before, because Global South voice has been greatly marginalized, like all the time, like G7 talking about all those issues, but now they cannot represent all the voice, all those concerns from global this village. And even security, this NATO, this itself is a result of the Cold War, but now remaining want to make it this influence, even go beyond Europe. Even want to talk about things like in Asia, saying there is a talking want to extend it, its role of NATO, go all the way to Asia, even beyond the Europe. Now, that's the reason. That's the challenge. That is why I think SCO, because originally it focused on anti-terror, border security, so it has accumulated a lot of experience on this matter. So you cannot just saying now we're moving into economic cooperation and then get away of all those rich experience of security cooperation. Of course not. So it will continue. So because this is becoming its very special feature, and then the BRICS country focus more on the economic cooperation. So each one, they have different folks, and they even have different members. You see the SCO normally is the Central Asian and the surrounding those countries now becoming member, observer country. But the BRICS goes, you know, Brazil, you know, South America, and South Africa, you know, in Africa continent, the new members like Egypt, Ethiopia, all representing Africa continent. So it goes even, you know, cover more from different those continents. So different one has different folks, has different advantage.
Well, during my research, I saw some Western analysts commented that the SCO is a place for conversation rather than a platform where collective decisions are made, implemented, and also have an impact, which means the SCO cannot be consequential. Professor Guthrie, what's your take?
Yeah, I disagree with that positioning of it. I mean, yes, it is true that there are a number of different venues in the world, and nations figure out exactly which venues are going to be the high profile ones at any given moment. But the important thing is that you have a number of different venues and a number of different cooperative organizations in which you're having conversations that are moving in similar directions. And that's, again, what I think is so interesting about this particular evolution of SCO. You know, SCO really, as we've discussed, began as an organization that was really focused on border security, anti-terrorism and such. And then you had BRICS over here, which was sort of a counterbalance to the G20, G7 way of thinking about economies. But today you have China involved in taking a leadership role in multiple organizations. So SCO, BRICS, you have the expansion of BRICS last year. And I think that these conversations continue along on multiple fronts, and they are both conversations about borders and securities and regions of the world, but also economies. And so I think all of this is about, you know, when we talk about, again, BRI as an example of an economic plan, we can think of it as an economic plan. But if you look more broadly at BRI, BRI is also about China's pivoting away from its fundamental dependence on its largest trading partners, in specific terms, the United States. Mm-hmm. And so I think that what we're seeing here is, you know, SCO, you can frame it as just a place where conversations are happening, but these are important consequential conversations that have implications for which regions and which groups of voices have power in the world in moving policies forward. And so I think it's much more than just a place of conversation. It's a place for setting the tone for a multipolar world.
Mm. Now, Dr. Sahakyan, coming from Central Asia, what's your take on this?
Actually, yes. Shanghai Cooperation Organization, we need to remember that it is institution, organization. And we have different states there which have cooperation and, of course, disagreements. But it is great that they are in this organization and they are trying to find solutions for further cooperation. And, of course, it is not just a place for chit-chat, but they are having two ways for negotiations. The first one is multilateral, when they are together trying to solve problems or find solutions. And the second, that we are having during these meetings, many bilateral meetings, and they are settling also problems between their nations. Therefore, I want to mention the Shanghai Cooperation Organization. It is a bridge.
Well, there are also Western critics who said the SCO is merely a block through which China intends to project its influence in the region. Dr. He, how would you respond to that?
Well, this is kind of correlated with the comments you mentioned before. That is, to answer the question, saying what is the responsibility of China, is going to play or has already played in both like SCO or like in the BRICS. Western critics always say, want to make this China role somehow overestimated. Somehow it's underestimated. I think both kind of way is not fit with the reality. Actually, because given the size of China, given the China's GDP, like second biggest economy, given the China now the one of those UN permanent the members in the Security Council. So, of course, China is not a little boy either in SCO or in the BRICS. China is a giant there. So it has its role. But China wouldn't like, it's not saying, wow, play our role, make us become, a bigger giant there. Make those SCO like BRICS in China's hands, in China's control. Oh, this is not China's intention at all. Even get rid of to behave like that way. We are always shared as an equal footing. Like that's why always saying Shanghai spirit. It's a very, very, key principle. Shanghai spirit, what is this? Saying mutual. Everything's mutual. Mutual trust, mutual confidence, equal, and consultation, and respect this diversity of different civilization and the common development. So everything. It's not saying who dominates where and where. Mm. But in terms of contribution, China always saying we would like to make more contribution like the BRI. China come out with the money, do a lot of FDI in all kinds of different economic corridor and this and that. So this is the way to understand, I think, China's role. Even though It's a very important country, economically speaking. But China also wants to keep a low profile and also equal footing way.
Right. Well, one of the areas the SCO focuses on is Central Asia. China hosted the first Central Asia Summit last year in Xi'an in northwest China. And also during this trip to Central Asia, President Xi Jinping paid state visits to Kazakhstan and Tajikistan. Dr. Sahakyan, strategically and economically, is China becoming increasingly important for Central Asian countries? And in forging closer ties with China, what are Central Asian countries looking for?
China is doing huge investments in Central Asian states. Also, it is supporting Central Asian states in the framework of Belt and Road Initiative to rebuild and modernize their transportation infrastructures, which is helping to connect different Eurasian regions. For this reason, of course, for Central Asia, China is very important because it has also a huge market where they are supplying their energy resources. It is worth to mention that, of course, for Central Asia, China is very important as it is buying oil and gas, but also for China, for its energy security, Central Asia is also very, very important region. And the second point is that for China, it is very crucial now in the era of Russo-Ukrainian war to develop new road, China, Central Asia, West Asia economic corridor for reaching out Western Asian and also European markets. Therefore, Central Asia is important crossroad, which is bringing some kind of bridging opportunities for China and Central Asia of different regions.
Mm. Well, what about vice versa, Dr. He Wenping? How important is Central Asia now for China strategically and economically?
Yeah, of course. It matters very much. Security speaking, you see, that is why Shanghai Cooperation Organization founded all the way in the year 2001. I mentioned already before, those three forces matters very much with this security. So now, economically, also very important. Xi Jinping mentioned this 21st century Silk Road, the economic cooperation belt. This thing, from Kazakhstan visit in the year 2013. I remember it's September by that year. Xi Jinping also took the office in that year. You see, the first year he took the office and then made a trip to Kazakhstan and then come out with this BRI. So that it means, of course, this is very important, Central Asian country for, you know, China's this BRI initiative will link all the way from, especially, open China's western part of China. Because all over the 40 years, China's open up to the outside world during the economic globalization. Many benefited for the eastern part of China. Mm. All those special economic zones, it's those coastal cities. Even now, east part of China is more developed than our western part of China. So now, with this BRI, we'll open economic connectivity with all those western part of China, Xinjiang, Tibetan, Ningxia, all of them. So this is also, will make China this balanced development, even called new free stage for open up. So this matters very much, economically speaking.
Mm. Well, Professor Guthrie, how do you view this strategic positioning and significance of Central Asia, for big powers? And, what's America's interest in this region?
Well, so here again, as I mentioned in my last answer, I think that there's an interesting moment of China's pivoting away from this fundamental dependence on the U.S. and NATO countries in terms of its economic development and growth. And so you see this movement away. You see very recently, I mean, China is no longer the largest trading partner with the United States. Mexico is, but China is investing tremendously in Mexico. And so you see China, I think, moving very intelligently in sort of sending out its trade tentacles to different places. And Central Asia then becomes a key part of this. I mean, I think in the global north, if we want to call it that, you know, I think there's this very arrogant positioning of like there's the global north and we're all the important economies of the world. And then there's the global south and there's China is in this odd position in the middle here. And I just think that we should all reject that. And I think China is rejecting that. And it's really the BRI, as I've mentioned, I think is really not just an economic move, but it's a political move of China becoming the leader of the global south. And so here, I think that it's really important for China's positioning. But I think Central Asia is, you know, it's a huge part of the world. It's massive population. And collectively, it's a very, very large economy. And you asked the question, what are the interests for the United States? Unfortunately, I think my country is thinking very myopically and narrowly right now. And so I don't even know if they know. Mm-hmm. I think a lot of politicians are just thinking like, who are our main competitors and how do we continue to be the dominant economy in the world? And this short-sightedness is it's stopping the United States from being innovative in terms of manufacturing and supply chain, et cetera. And so the United States should care more than it does about Central Asia. It probably will start to care more because it is going to notice that China is in the middle of this pivoting away. And so I think it's a very interesting moment for both China and its role in the region, but also the ways in which the United States is going to continue to pay attention now.
That's an interesting point. And certainly, you know, with more cooperation between China and Central Asian countries, we'll see more projects. For example, the China-Kyrgyzstan-Uzbekistan railway project, which has been just agreed and signed off by these three countries in late June. Well, I wish we had more time, but that is all the time we have for this edition of World Today. Again, I want to thank our guests. They are Dr. He Wenping, Senior Research Fellow at Chinese Academy of Social Sciences, Dr. Mher Sahakyan, Founder and Director of China-Eurasia Council for Political and Strategic Research, a foundation in Armenia. Also, we have Professor Doug Guthrie, Director of China Initiatives at Thunderbird School of Global Management. If you want to catch up with more of our discussions, you can find our podcast by searching World Today. You can also follow us on the X platform at CGTN Radio. I'm Liu Kun in Beijing. Thank you for staying with us. Bye for now.